Hi everyone, I wanted to give you an update on the status of the Smoothieboard V2 project. On the firmware front, Jim Morris has ported a big chunk of the code to the new architecture. It's currently capable of laser cutting and CNC milling, with 3D printing coming soon. A lot of the more peripheral code still needs to be ported, but it's already usable. On the board side of things, we've had protos of V2 Mini, the lower cost, simpler variant made. And tested. We had protos of the V2 Pro, the expensive one with the FPGA made too. But the design of that one has changed so much since that we'll do another round of protos for it. And right now, Mark is working on the design of the proper V2 board, the middle board that will succeed the current V1. And we are very close to making an actual prototype run of that one. So once we make that run of prototypes, we'll have prototypes of each and every one of the three V2 boards, and we'll be ready to start a Kickstarter for the project. You can read the specs at the link in the description. Here's a tour of the main features and novelties for the main V2 board. The microcontroller changes. We're using a more recent, much faster microcontroller with 204 MHz versus 120 MHz for the previous one. It's got more features and it's got much more RAM. We are at 264 kilobytes versus 64 kilobytes for the current board. And considering the version 1 board is running out of RAM, this is going to be very useful. This board has no internal flash, which means we have to use external flash, which means we can have more flash than microcontrollers typically have. It's got a floating point unit, which is going to help a lot with the planning side of things. It's got a M0 coprocessor, which we hope to experiment with using for step generation, though we are not sure if that's going to work or not. It's going to be running the new V2 firmware, which is built on top of a RTOS, which is called Nutex. And we've got somebody working on a very awesome bootloader for it, which will, amongst other things, be able to unpack tar files, which means we'll be able to distribute other files with the firmware, like web interfaces and such. On the flash side of things, so we're using an external flash chip. On the board right now, we've got an 8 megabytes flash chip. It's using parallel interface, which means it's going to be very fast to access it. And right now, the V2 firmware is already 1 megabyte, which means we really need the external flash because it wouldn't fit in a normal microcontroller. On the logic power side, we've got a 3 amps, 5 volt, voltage regulator on the board. Contrary to V1, where this was an optional part, it's now soldered by default. 3 amps is a lot more than the 1 amp max we had on the V1 board, which means you'll be able to power more peripherals and power things like a Raspberry Pi directly from the board. For the SD card, V1 was using SPI, which was very slow, but V2 will be using SDIO, which is much faster. We expect to see speeds in the range of megabytes per second. On the USB side, V1 only had a B connector, which is the kind of connector you use to connect to a computer, but V2 will also have an A connector, which is what you use, for example, to plug in a thumb drive. This will allow you to grab G-code files and copy them to the Smoothieboard in a much safer fashion than when people were using like external SD cards. We are also working on implementing USB MTP, which serves the same function as USB MSD or mass storage, which was the interface you used to copy files directly to the SD card on the board. But MTP is much safer. With MSD, you weren't able to access the SD card from the computer and from the Smoothieboard, which prevented us from doing things like having log files. But with V2 and MTP, you'll be able to access the SD card from the computer and from the Smoothieboard, which will allow us to have a lot of new functionality. For Ethernet, V1 had a very severe limitation in that you couldn't really refresh the web interface while it was printing. That was just too much for the board and it could crash. But for V2, since it's being rebuilt on top of a RTOS, this means it should be safe now to do much more with the web interface without having to worry about crashes or speed limits. The board will also feature a simple interface to plug in a Raspberry Pi, like the Raspberry Pi Zero, which should make it easier to set up things like an OctoPi setup. On the stepper driver side of things, we'll be using four TMC2660 stepper drivers from Trinamic. Those are a very nice micro-stepping driver with 1/256 micro-stepping and 2.8 amps max. For people who need more drivers than this, we'll also be making kits to easily add access to any board. For the connectors that provide power to the stepper motor drivers, we'll be using XT30. XT30 is a connector commonly used on things like drones for batteries. It's nice because it's very sturdy and it can handle up to 30 amps, which is much more than we had on the V1, which was limited to 12.5 amps. V2 also has an input for the MOSFETs, so you still have the ability to use different voltages for the MOSFETs and the stepper motor drivers, which is nice. You can, for example, use 12 volts for one and 24 volts for the other. The MOSFET input comes installed with a safety MOSFET, which means if the board detects something wrong, like a temperature runaway, it will turn off power to all MOSFETs at once. This means that even if one of your heating MOSFETs fails and keeps heating non-stop, the board will still be able to cut power, which makes the board much safer. Right now, you can do this with V1, but it requires adding a relay or something like that. But with V2, it will be directly on board. On the MOSFET side, there's one big MOSFET that's designed to handle heated beds that will have an XT30 connector output. Two smaller MOSFETs for things like OTAMs, so you'll still be able to do dual extrusion. And one fan MOSFET. On the analog side of things, the board has three thermistor inputs. Those are very well protected. We also have an analog output, and the board can do power sense, which means if you provide 12 or 24 volts to your stepper motors, for example, the board can measure if it's like 11 or 13 volts, or if the power turns off, it can sense things like that. It also has two general purpose digital output, which can be used for example, for servo motors or SSRs or solid state relays. The board has seven end stop inputs, six for classic end stops and one that's designed for Z-probe. The Z-probe input is 36 volt tolerant, so you can plug in capacitive probes directly into it without having to add like voltage divider or something. The board also has seven gadgeteer ports. Gadgeteer ports are meant to make it much easier to expand the board. Those are standard ports with different capabilities each, like PWM or analog, and we'll be making a lot of expansion boards that plug into these. So, for example, if you want to add a MOSFET or add a Raspberry Pi or add a laser control system or whatever, we'll have lots of extension boards for that, and you'll be able to just plug in the board. About the board itself, the PCB, it's an 8-layer board, so it's going to have very good heat sinking. The connector distribution, we make sure to, like for V1, to have all connectors as much as possible on the outside of the board, and everything that's meant to interface with the exterior of the machine, like USB ports, Ethernet, etc., is on the same side of the board. Contrary to V1, this board this time will have a proper G-tag, which is very nice for debugging. For the dimensions of the board is going to be 120 by 120 millimeters, so this is a square, and the holes are 100 millimeters by 100 millimeters apart, so it's very easy to remember the dimensions for this board. Those are the basic features of the board, but if you want to know more, you can read the specs. If you want to be warned, as soon as the Kickstarter campaign starts, you can email vov.arthur@gmail.com. I'd like to thank a lot of people, but for this video, Jim Morris, who did the firmware port, Mark, who is working on the hardware design right now, Adam Green, who's been very supportive on the debug side of things. Also, two companies, Be Very Creative and Layer One, who have helped with either the firmware or the hardware with money and stuff. So thanks a lot to them, they helped push the project along. Thanks, I'll try to make another video soon.